Welcome, everyone, to our very first FKC patient forum on the COVID vaccine. As Abraham mentioned, my name is Pinocchio, and I work in the medical office at Fresenius Medical Care in North America. There has been a lot of interest in the COVID-19 vaccine, and today's patient forum has been specifically designed to allow you, our dialysis patients, the opportunity to submit your questions and or concerns so that we can be here to address your questions with the experts that we have on the line today. As a, for today's call, I am privileged to be joined by my colleagues, Dr. Michael Krause, Associate Chief Medical Officer for Fresenius Medical Care, and Dr. Chance Nisafong, our clinical pharmacist also with Fresenius Kidney Care. Welcome, gentlemen.
Thanks, Paneth. This is really exciting, and hopefully we'll get a lot of good information for our patients.
Okay. Dr. Krause, to kick off this patient forum, why is it important that our dialysis patients, both within Fresenius as well as in our dialysis community, that they get vaccinated?
That's the key reason we're here today. I mean, this is exceedingly important. And it's frankly, it's not important just for the patients, but also their families for the same reasons. And the reasons are, we know that dialysis patients are more likely to get infected with the COVID-19 virus. They're more likely to have severe disease, and frankly, one in two of them require hospitalizations for the COVID-19 virus. And we've also seen that there's an increased death rate among patients, dialysis patients, who get infected with the COVID-19 virus. So the vaccine is to protect them, reduce their risks, and also getting their family vaccinated reduces their risk.
So with the availability of three COVID-19 vaccines as of April of this year, it's really exciting that these vaccines are giving both our dialysis community and the general population hope that there could be a light at the end of the tunnel. When we look at two of the vaccines that are currently available, both the Pfizer and the Moderna, which are considered to be messenger RNA or mRNA vaccines, Dr. Krause, could you provide an overview of exactly how do these two mRNA vaccines work?
Absolutely. The mRNA technology is exciting technology, and the SARS-CoV-2 virus is the perfect candidate for this kind of vaccine. What we do is simply inject in a fat vesicle a small code of messenger RNA, which is in all our cells. It's throughout our bodies, but this is specific messenger RNA that goes to the cell, particularly the cells that naturally produce your immunity, and teach them to make the proteins that are on top of the SARS-CoV-2 or the COVID-19 virus. So what we're doing is teaching our body to respond to the virus. We're not injecting the virus. We're just simply injecting a small piece of mRNA, makes the proteins, and then gets reused for nucleic acids, which are throughout our bodies. It's a very natural immunity, and one that's more robust than you might get even with just the viral infection itself.
Thank you, Dr. Krause. So just a follow-up to the information you just shared with our patients, you had mentioned that the mRNA vaccines, both the Pfizer and Moderna vaccines, are injecting mRNA into the body. That sounds pretty scary. So for our dialysis patients that are listening in today, should they be concerned about the chances that these mRNA COVID-19 vaccines could actually interfere with our DNA or our genetic makeup?
Oh, absolutely none. That is actually the beauty of this messenger RNA. It doesn't even go into the nucleus or the center of the cell where your DNA lives. It's absolutely impossible, and it doesn't interact with your DNA at all.
Okay. Thank you. And Chance, when we talk about mRNA, I know there are differences of which shots require one versus two shots. How many shots are required for the mRNA to be considered vaccinated?
Yeah, thank you for that question, Panette. So currently, both the mRNA vaccines that are available in the U.S. require two shots. One of them being the Pfizer vaccine that requires two shots at 21 days apart, and with the Moderna vaccine that requires also two shots at 28 days apart.
And aside from how they're separated between the Pfizer and Moderna, are there any differences that our patients should be aware of between the Pfizer and Moderna, or are they the same? Do they work equally well in patients?
Yeah, so with both mRNA vaccines, from what we know so far, I mean, the response, the protective response of these two vaccines are essentially the same, right? One is, I mean, both vaccines have shown greater than 90% efficacy at protecting you from severe or SARS-CoV-2 infection or COVID infection. So if you get a chance to get any of these vaccines, get it. I mean, they essentially have no difference in clinical outcomes.
Okay. Thank you, Chance. And Dr. Krause, at the beginning, you started out telling us about the mRNA vaccines and how they work. There's another type of vaccine that's available in the U.S. called the Johnson & Johnson Janssen vaccine. Can you go, it's very similar to how you explain how mRNA works. Can you explain to our listeners, how do the J&J or Janssen vaccine work?
It's interestingly similar, but a little bit farther downstream. So the J&J vaccine or the Janssen vaccine, actually it puts their code, instead of in that fat vesicle that the mRNA vaccines use, inside what's called an adenovirus vector, which is a simple cold virus, but it's been inactivated, so it can't replicate, it can't make you sick. It's just a carrier. It carries its message into your cell. And that message then goes into your cell and tells your body to make the mRNA that the other two vaccines actually use. So it codes for similar spike proteins by going into your cell, telling your cell to make the mRNA, and then the mRNA is naturally then coded to those spike proteins that the other vaccines is very similar. So it's just, it's the messenger that's changed, right? It's the vesicle that gets it, the truck that gets it to the your cells.
And Dr. Krause, for the J&J Janssen vaccine, do they also require two doses, or is this the vaccine that requires one dose?
Well, this one does have the added benefit of requiring only one dose at this time and being very efficacious and effective and probably very similar to the mRNA effectiveness. We're actually quite pleased. So it has that one single advantage of being a single injection.
Thank you, Dr. Krause. Chance, as a follow-up to what Dr. Krause mentioned in terms of saying there are three vaccines available, knowing that there are different types of vaccines available to the U.S. population, is there one vaccine from your clinical perspective that's better than the other since there are three on the market today?
Yeah, thank you, Finette. So from my perspective, I mean, clinically, you can't compare all three vaccines because the head-to-head comparison was never done in a clinical trial. But according to what we know so far, all three vaccines are effective at preventing the disease. And, you know, there's no disadvantage to getting one or the other. So I would recommend get any of these vaccines that you can, so you can be protected sooner from the virus.
Dr. Krause, there have been some concerns that we've been hearing over these past couple of months that some colleagues or some patients, as well as some folks in the general community, believe that if they were to get the COVID-19 vaccine, that they will most likely get sick or come down with COVID-19. Should they be any concern that if they get the vaccine, that they will invariably get COVID-19 from the vaccine?
Well, first, let's be clear. Absolutely not. So you cannot get COVID-19 from any of these three vaccines. None of them carry the COVID-19 virus itself. Again, the adenovirus vector of the Janssen is a completely different virus, and it's inactivated, can't cause an infection, but none of them carry the SARS-CoV-2 or the COVID-19 vaccine. So it's, you cannot get COVID-19 from the vaccine, but I do want to caution, you can still get COVID-19 infection from the virus from somebody else, particularly between the first two injections. So again, the importance is get your vaccine and wear a mask, still socially isolate, and keep yourself safe, especially while your body's responding to the vaccines, which in general we think is 2 weeks after the second vaccine.
Thank you, Dr. Grouse. Now, on March 25th, the dialysis community received some wonderful news. The White House announced that they would start a national plan where they would provide direct allocation of the Pfizer mRNA COVID-19 vaccine to the entire U.S. dialysis centers nationwide. So, Dr. Krause, can you take a brief moment here and explain what exactly does this mean for the renal community and our dialysis patients? How is this different from how vaccines are currently being allocated in the general community?
So, Panath, as you might recall, initially when the federal government released the vaccines, they said we're releasing it to the states, and the states are deciding how to pass out the vaccines. We at Fresenius have been working very hard with all of the states and counties that are in charge, trying to figure out how we can get our patients taken care of and our employees taken care of. In addition, we had been working with the federal government as much as we could to get this national plan that was just rolled out. So we relied on the states and counties, and in some states we were really fortunate enough to get the vaccine for our patients and our care team members before this recent federal announcement. But now with the federal announcement, we can get it from the federal government and give it in all the states. But as a result, we're not going to take the federal vaccines and go to the states we've already given it. So there may be some confusion where you're at. So I want you to be careful. I want you to make sure you understand. We now have the ability to give the vaccine in all of our dialysis units, and we'll be doing so where we haven't done it previously. But if there's question, I think all the patients should talk to their care team directly and understand what options are available in their area and make sure they still can receive the vaccine.
And just as a follow-up to what Dr. Krause mentioned, Chance, for some of our dialysis patients who have been patiently yet eagerly waiting to get notified when they would be eligible to get vaccinated, can you reiterate exactly how they will be notified if it is in a state that where they can receive the federal allocation? How will our dialysis patient get notified when they're eligible for the Pfizer vaccine to be administered in their dialysis clinic?
Sure, Fanette. So your care team will actually notify you when the vaccines are available in your center. So we appreciate your patience that we distribute the vaccines available to us as quickly and safely as possible. So with that, if you have any questions or concerns, reach out to your care team, because the vaccine is coming, but logistically, there's a challenge to distribute these kind of vaccines through all our clinics.
Yeah, and Chance, as a follow-up to that, Dr. Krause had mentioned that some patients can get it from the state, some patients can get it through the clinic. Should our dialysis patients wait to hear from the dialysis clinics first, or what should be the recommendation?
Yeah, the recommendation right now is absolutely not. You should get the vaccine where it's available. So you have the opportunity to receive your vaccines outside of Fresenius. Don't hesitate to take it. So if the vaccine is available to you through hospitals, health networks, pharmacy, or any other channels, please take advantage and the chance to receive the vaccine as soon as possible.
Thanks, Chance. So, Dr. Krause, over the last couple of months, we've also been hearing some concerns from both the general population, our employees, as well as our patients, that they're a little bit concerned about the speed to which these vaccines were developed. And they were wondering, has the safety of the vaccines been compromised in order to get it out into the public domain? Can you share any feedback on whether these concerns are valid or clarify this disinformation?
I think it's important to note that this hasn't been rushed. This actually has been followed the same safety and efficacy concerns of any vaccine on the market. So we feel very comfortable. Now, it seemed rushed for a couple of reasons. One, the lay press said it would take us years to get there. Clearly, it didn't. So let's think about why it came so quickly. First of all, both the mRNA vaccine and the adenovirus vector, the Johnson & Johnson vaccine, have been in studies for 30 to 40 years. These are not new vaccines, although somewhat novel to us. The adenovirus vaccine has been used in Ebola, so we knew what they were. We've been prepared. We've been studying viruses with these vaccines for a long time. We've actually used these vaccines in animal and human models, depending which one we talk about. But the important thing is mRNA is simple to manufacture as opposed to standard vaccines where you have to grow a virus, inactivate the virus, and you're actually growing real viruses. We don't have to do this. They can just manufacture the mRNA, which is a much faster practice. And then the other thing that sped us up is we were prepared. There were patients willing to do the studies already signed up even before the vaccines were developed. That takes time. That was sped up. So we were able to get the vaccines into arms faster once they were created. And then the final thing that sped this so that you and I can get these vaccines quickly is the governments of our country and a few other countries bought the vaccines before the test studies were done, meaning we told Moderna, Pfizer, and Johnson & Johnson and others to go ahead and make vaccines. We'll pay for them, and if the studies are good, we'll use them. If the studies aren't good, then we just won't use them. So fortunately, the three vaccines that we have are safe and effective, and because we processed them or we manufactured them even before the studies were done, as soon as the FDA said this is safe, this is effective, we were able to move it to patients the next day. And it's very exciting to see how we worked there. So the process itself was not rushed. Parts of the process were faster because of the types of vaccine and the way we planned ahead.
And Dr. Krauss, that's really reassuring to hear. But one of the other questions we've received is could the speed at which some of these vaccines were developed, could any of the steps have been skipped or bypassed in order to get it to the market?
Oh, absolutely not. One of the other things that was done with this vaccine is the FDA was getting the data in real time and discussing with the pharmaceutical companies what needed to be done to make sure the vaccines were safe and effective, what needed to be done so they could get that emergency use authorization as quickly as possible. So no steps were skipped. We collaborated better, we planned better, and rest assured, these are safe and effective vaccines.
Chance, so with the information that Dr. Krauss just shared with us, it is reassuring to know that there was a pragmatic approach at getting these vaccines to the market sooner than later because of the pandemic. But we still have some patients, as well as folks in the general population, who are still a little bit worried that perhaps the vaccines are just too new and they just have not had enough time to be monitored for safety. Could you share with our listeners how the government is actually looking at monitoring the safety and effectiveness of these vaccines while it is in emergency use?
Yeah, thank you for that question. So there's several ways the governments are monitoring the vaccine safety and efficacies right now. I mean, the first one being the pre-existing system that we have in place already called the VARS, Vaccine Adverse Event Reporting. So that one is being employed as a passive response. So you can actually, any kind of vaccine reaction, anything like that gets reported into that system. And it's a requirement that any vaccinator report to that system if there is any kind of reaction. The other one is more of an active response to where there's an active questionnaire that gets sent out to the patient each day to see what the signs and symptoms are, to keep track of if there's any adverse events that are happening. So that one is a new system that's developed and actually really showing us some good data so far. And with this vaccine that's currently being rolled out right now, we're not seeing that, you know, side effects that people are talking about in the press. So there's other mechanisms too that the state levels are also looking at and also monitoring along with the federal government to see, to still monitor if the vaccines are safe and effective for our patients. So just rest assured that all of these systems are in place to monitor these vaccines to make sure they're safe. And if there's any signals at all that these vaccines are unsafe, they would be immediately pulled from use.
Thank you, Chance. That is really great to hear that we do have systems in place to make sure that they are actively tracking and watching to see if there are any unintended side effects that the general population should be aware of. Dr. Krause, you had alluded to this in your earlier information that you shared. When we talk about once you get your full dose of the COVID-19, when are you actually considered fully vaccinated or fully protected?
Well, that's an important question. And for most of us and the people that were studied, it is 2 weeks after your last dose. So 2 weeks after your Johnson & Johnson vaccine or 2 weeks after your second dose of Pfizer or Moderna. It should be important to note for our patients, we still have to study it in end-stage renal disease, and we'll continue to monitor it carefully. There are some hints that your antibody response may be a little bit lower than other people, but the vaccine is hugely important because people do respond, they do develop antibodies, and we'll just have to continue to monitor it and make sure we know the best way going forward to continue to keep our dialysis patients safe as well.
So, Chance, as a follow-up to the question I just posed to Dr. Krause, there's been a lot of questions about how long will the vaccine actually protect me? Do we have any information at the duration or how long someone can be protected after receiving the completed cycle of vaccine?
Yeah, from the most current data that we have right now, we know that these patients or these participants that are in the original studies, they're showing protective rate of at least 6 months or longer, so 6 months being the minimum. But when you look at the vaccine participant versus people that have been infected, the response, the immune response is actually a lot higher with the vaccine participants. So we expect them to have protection a lot longer than, you know, at least a year or longer with the vaccine.
So speaking to that, Chance, I'm going to follow up with you. Can you explain, and I know you and Dr. Krause mentioned this in your past information, what is the difference between the immunity you get from a past infection versus the immunity that you get from a vaccine?
Yeah, that's an excellent question. And it's something with natural immunity, with when you get infected with the virus itself, you do show a response and protection that lasts, you know, about the same time, about 6 months. But the level of response, that level of immune response is not as strong, it's not as vigorous as you would with the vaccine. With the vaccine response, your immune response is about 8 times higher than what you would see in the natural infection, or even greater in some people. So with that being said, the protection is more than likely it's going to last longer than you would have with the natural immunity. That's the reason why we encourage people with prior infection with the virus to actually get the vaccine so they can actually boost their response. And there was a recent article that just came out recently that actually shows that that's exactly what's happening with people with prior infection. It actually boosted their immune response.
So Chance, as a follow-up to that, so if they have had COVID-19 previously and have recovered, there should not be any reasons for why they should hold off from getting vaccinated. Did I hear you correctly?
Yes, that's correct. So we encourage people to get vaccinated even though they have prior infection. So there's caveats to that. So with people with you know, symptomatic infection, we ask that you wait just slightly a little bit to wait until your infection resolves and give your body a little amount of time to rest your immune response before getting the vaccine. But if you were infected without any symptoms, you know, you would wait that isolation period before getting the vaccine, just to make sure you don't have a more vigorous immune response.
And Dr. Krause, once a patient gets vaccinated, what are the most common side effects that our patients or anybody who gets a COVID-19 vaccine should they expect once they get that shot?
Well, for our patients, the side effects are no different than they are for any other patient. So those patients without dialysis have the same sort of side effects that we would expect in dialysis patients. The most is obviously pain at the injection site, just like you might get with any shot. There may also be some redness or warmth at the injection site. And then a percentage of patients will get I feel achy and tired and even can develop a fever, usually just a low-grade fever. It should be important to note these symptoms generally occur 18 to 24 hours after the vaccine, and they generally last no longer than another 24 to 36 hours. They tend to respond to Tylenol, and so if there's not an allergy to Tylenol, that's probably the best medicine to take. If you have some of these symptoms, rest and relaxation works for most of us.
Thank you, Dr. Krause. Chance, we've heard in some of our discussions with dialysis patients that some patients have seen on social media or other news network that they could possibly take some medications or herbals in advance of receiving their COVID-19 vaccines to prevent these side effects from occurring that Dr. Krause mentioned. How would you advise our dialysis patients on this information?
So that information is false. The one you find on social media to say, you know, pre-medicate with these medications. The current recommendation by the CDC right now is to actually only take the medication when you have symptoms. So that's usually after you get vaccinated. And there's also reasons why you want to do that too, because if you take that pre-medication before the vaccine, it might make the vaccine actually become less effective. So that's the reason why you don't want to take it before getting the vaccine injection. So The ideal situation is to wait until you have symptoms, then you can take that medication. So, I mean, being a pharmacist, I would tell you don't take medication unless you have to. I mean, but some, I mean, that's too only to the vaccine.
Perfect. Thank you, Chance. And Dr. Krause, you had mentioned about dialysis patients, perhaps maybe having a different response than the general population. Now, when we look at some patients who may have some autoimmune conditions, such as lupus or Crohn's, are these patients who have these autoimmune conditions, should they receive the COVID-19 vaccine or should they hold out from receiving it?
Yes, and I want to clarify, it's dialysis patients still respond to the vaccine in great numbers. The response seems to be just a little bit less, so it's very important that they get this. I don't want anybody to walk away thinking they're not going to respond, so don't get the shot. So first and foremost, dialysis patients definitely should get the shot. Secondly, for other immune complex diseases, like you mentioned, it is most definitely recommended because these people, are at higher risk from the virus than most people. The concern is obviously, will my response be robust enough? And we don't have enough information to know that. Of the patients that have received the vaccine, it looks like it does work for most of these patients. If there's questions, discuss that with your physician. But I would anticipate a response in most, if not all, of these patients, and I would anticipate a safer progression by getting vaccinated.
Thank you, Dr. Krause. Chance, we've been hearing some news in the media that there are some people who develop severe or immediate allergic reaction after getting their COVID-19 vaccines. Are there certain or specific patient population who should avoid getting the COVID-19 vaccine?
Sure. I mean, there's actually two contraindications to the different platforms of the vaccine. So with the mRNA vaccines, you're allergic to polyethylene glycol, which is Miralax, if for the common term. It's the one that you cannot get the vaccine if you're allergic, have any kind of allergy to that vaccine or medication. The other contraindication to the mRNA vaccine is you have any kind of immediate reaction after the first dose is to not get a follow-up dose with that same vaccine. So the other one, the Johnson & Johnson vaccine, if you have allergies to polysorbate 80, is the contraindication of that vaccine. But according to the CDC, you can get one after the other if you have allergies. So let's say you have allergies to mRNA vaccines and you only got the first dose of that and develop an immediate allergic reaction. You can have a follow-up second shot with the Johnson & Johnson vaccine to make your series complete. But you cannot get a follow-up with the different mRNA vaccine.
And Chance, if a patient did have a severe or immediate allergic reaction, what should they do when they come back for their second shot or when they register for their second shot?
Yeah, make sure you tell your vaccinator that you had an allergic reaction to that vaccine so they do not give you another shot of that vaccine. So with that being said, you know, we do have systems in place to monitor for people that do have severe allergic reactions. So, you know, there's guidance set up by the government and the CDC to say to have medication in place. If there's any kind of allergic reaction like that happening, is to immediately treat that patient so it doesn't lead to any kind of severe outcomes. And so far, I mean, with that guidance, we have not seen any vaccine allergic reaction that resulted in severe outcomes or, you know, worse outcomes. Most patients were able to be treated immediately.
Right, you're absolutely right. We have not heard of any reports where the allergic reaction resulted in death based on the information that the CDC released to us. That's correct, right, Chance?
Yes, that's correct. So we have not heard anything that's related to allergic reactions that, you know, we were not able to treat.
And Chance, it's true that these allergic reactions are exceedingly rare still, correct?
Yeah, compared to, let's say, penicillin, for example. I mean, some patients can have allergies. 15% of patients can have allergies to penicillin. I mean, these vaccines are, the allergic reaction to vaccines are extremely rare. I mean, it's probably less than 1% right now that we know of that have a reaction to the vaccine. But the reason why a lot of you are hearing about it is because, you know, there's more scrutiny on the vaccine, being that it was released this year and it was something new. So, you know, people are keeping a closer eye on it. But compared to other medications, other vaccines, it's pretty much, you know, comparable to the other vaccines that you have on the market now.
And keeping along the same topic of allergies, Dr. Kraus, if any patient has a food allergy, such as a nut or peanut allergy, is it still safe for them to get the COVID-19 vaccine?
This is an important question because it has changed from early on discussion, but clearly we now feel comfortable in saying that if you have an allergy to food, nuts, even most medicines, it's go ahead and get your COVID-19 vaccine. We've not seen any increased risk from doing that. What we do ask is if you have a history of severe allergies of any kind, when you go to get your vaccine, again, you notify the nurse that's giving you the vaccine, the people that are giving you the vaccine, and what they'll do is they'll watch you for a little bit longer. So 15 minutes for most people, they'll extend that to 30 minutes if you have a history of any sort of allergic reaction. And the nice thing to note is these severe allergic reactions occur almost always within that first 30 minutes. So yes, get the vaccine. Yes, discuss it with the personnel giving you the vaccine. Anticipate that to stay for 30 minutes and make sure if you're beginning to experience any symptoms, you tell them immediately.
Thank you, Dr. Kraus. So Chance, going back to the topic of the dialysis clinics being able to have direct receipt or direct access of the COVID-19 vaccine. Outside of the care team, the dialysis care team and the dialysis patients, can family members or caregivers of our dialysis patients also receive the vaccine?
Yeah, thank you for the question. So our immediate priority right now is to vaccinate our patients and our direct patient care team. So we have established our prioritization approach that will continue to give precedence to patients and care teams while making sure guidelines are in place for vaccinating groups like patient care, caregivers, and immediate family members if extra vaccine is available. So we do have that plan in place, but right now our immediate needs and our priorities are to our patients and our staff that are taking care of our patients.
Thanks, Chance. So Dr. Krause, I think I posed an earlier question to you about people's concerns about the speed at which the vaccines were developed. So because of some of these fears or concerns, some people are wondering or possibly deciding if they should hold off from getting the vaccine because they don't want to be the first group to receive the vaccine. What are your thoughts on the wait and see approach?
I think you've succeeded in that if you haven't had your vaccine yet. The vaccines have now been in arms, as you're aware, for quite a few months now. And about one in four people in the United States today are fully vaccinated. And probably close to half of the people in the United States have been vaccinated with at least one shot. So we're talking literally close to 200 million people. I think they announced 160 million the other day. But clearly, people are being vaccinated. You wait and see. We've seen the results. There's been, as Chance mentioned earlier, there's a very transparent monitoring system in place looking for any adverse events. So all three vaccines have been given to tens of millions of people in the cases of Pfizer and Moderna vaccine, and just under 10 million people in the case of the Johnson & Johnson vaccine. So the wait and see is over. These are safe. These are effective. Get the vaccine as soon as you can. Protect yourself and those around you.
Chance, as you and Dr. Krause mentioned about the dosing requirements between the Pfizer and Moderna mRNA vaccines, which requires two doses, while the Johnson & Johnson or Janssen COVID-19 vaccine requires one shot, some people may wonder, can they just take one shot of the mRNA vaccine and still have the same protection as the one shot of the Janssen or the Johnson & Johnson vaccine? Can they just abbreviate the dosing to just one dose with the mRNA?
No, I mean, currently the recommendation is to actually complete the two-dose series with the mRNA vaccine. And we're seeing, like, now in some of our, you know, patient population, like, we're constantly doing studies to see what it looks like when the patient do receive vaccines. And you may not have the complete immune response until the second shot, like Dr. Krause mentioned earlier, for at least until 2 weeks after the second shot. So the recommendation is get your series, complete the two-dose series, and don't try to only abbreviate it to one shot with the mRNA vaccine.
Thank you, Jan. And Dr. Krause, as a follow-up to that, if a patient does complete their series, whether it's the two doses with the mRNA or the one dose with the Johnson & Johnson vaccine, why is it important for people to still wear their mask after getting vaccinated with any of these three vaccines?
It's important for many reasons, particularly in our dialysis population. Like I said earlier, we are still studying to see how effective and how long that effectiveness will be in our dialysis patients. It may turn out, like we see in hepatitis B, they need an additional booster of this vaccine down the future. Secondly, none of the vaccines are 100% effective, although they are 100% effective thus far in preventing severe disease and even death from COVID-19. You can still get it, which means you could still potentially pass it on to somebody else. So you get the vaccine to build your immunity. You wear the mask to protect yourself even further and also protect others.
Thank you, Dr. Graf. And Chance, maybe you can help clarify this information here. Is there may be some misinformation or misconceptions out there about this, but if someone has received the flu vaccine will the flu vaccine protect them against COVID-19? And on the flip side, if someone gets a COVID-19, can they skip the flu vaccine because the COVID-19 vaccine can also not only protect them from COVID, but can also protect them from the flu?
So the short answer to that is no. I mean, you cannot just take one over the other because these are two different viruses, right? You do still need the flu vaccination, the yearly flu vaccination, along with the COVID vaccine. So that's to protect you against the two different viruses. I mean, one for the flu and one for the SARS-CoV-2 virus.
Thank you, Chance. And Dr. Krause, you know, over the last few months, we've been hearing a lot about these emerging variants of the COVID-19 virus. We know first it kind of started being reported outside the U.S., and now we're seeing these variants pop up in many states across the U.S. What should our dialysis patients know about these COVID-19 variants?
Well, there's a couple things that are very important about these variants, especially the one that's now taking over the United States, the so-called UK variant, or what is known as B1117. It is a virus that appears to be more virulent, meaning it's more contagious. So it's easier to spread quickly. And we're seeing that in a number of states this morning. I just noticed that on the television and the websites. It is increasing in a number of states, and we're going to have to be cautious. The good news is the vaccine is protective against them as well. So the important point to know about the variants is the best way to take care of the variants is vaccinate as many people as possible. The second most important thing to note is with these variants out there, as you're getting vaccinated, even more important to remain vigilant. Please wear your masks in and out of the dialysis unit. Please wash your hands and socially isolate as much as possible, and just take good care of yourself. It is really hard. We're all getting tired of COVID vaccine or COVID-19, and we all want to go back to where we were. But this is not the time, especially for my dialysis patients with the risk. This disease, these variants are just a little bit more infectious and maybe a little bit more virulent. So vaccinate as quickly as possible. Which whatever vaccine you can get, wear your mask, wash your hands, and socially isolate.
And Chance, do you have any additional parting words before we end our COVID-19 vaccine patient forum?
Yes, thank you, Panette. So, I mean, just to remind everyone, so these vaccines are pretty much our most hopeful solution to ending this pandemic. And in order to do that, I mean, we would all have to do our part in getting vaccinated and protecting ourselves from, this virus, and also protecting other people that we care about. And the best solution to this is getting vaccinated. I mean, I can keep repeating that. And, you know, right now, I mean, currently, there's not a lot of therapies for people that are infected with COVID-19. The best solution, I think, to anything is prevention, and the vaccines is our answer.
And Dr. Krause, you had made some excellent statements prior to Chance's parting words. I'd like to give you a chance to provide any last-minute remarks before we end our call.
Well, thanks, Panette. And I just want to, again, reiterate, don't worry about where we are with vaccines and dialysis patients and your response. Get the vaccine. It will protect you. It is safe. It's effective. But importantly, remind your family and those around you that you would like them to be vaccinated. Don't be afraid to speak up and ask people to get the right information, much like this program we're giving today. Remain safe. Remain vigilant. It's been a long year, but we've got a few more months before we're hopefully where we want to be. So get vaccinated. Urge your family to get vaccinated. Wear your mask and socially isolate and wash your hands. We just have to ride this out for just a short time more.
So, Dr. Krause, Chance, thank you so much for your time in participating in this patient forum. On behalf of Fresenius Medical Care, we would like to thank all of our patients who have taken the time to dial into this patient forum call. with the information that our medical experts, Dr. Krause and Maisa Fong, has shared with you today, we hope we have actually provided you with reliable information, and hopefully this has empowered you, as Dr. Krause mentioned, to motivate you to get your COVID-19 vaccine if you have not already received it. And if you have already received it, as Dr. Krause and Chance mentioned, please continue to do the non-pharmacologic interventions of socially distancing, washing your hands, and disinfecting your surfaces. If you have any additional questions that perhaps were not answered by Dr. Krause or Dr. Chance Maisafong, please do not hesitate to reach out to us, and you can email us your questions using the following address: vaccines, that's VACCINES, at FreseniusKidneyCare.com. We will make it a priority that one member of our medical team will follow up with you and address your questions or concerns. Additionally, we are continuing to update our Fresenius Kidney Care website with current information as they unfold. As Chance mentioned, there is constantly new information about COVID-19 and the vaccine, and it's important for us as an organization that we keep you all, as our dialysis patients, up to date with this information. So for continued updated information on COVID-19 and the vaccines, please do not hesitate to visit our website, www.FreseniusKidneyCare.com/coronavirus, to learn more. And I can't reiterate the statements that, again, Dr. Krause and Dr. Chance Maisafong has already stated before. We want you to protect yourself as well as others around you by getting vaccinated, and as well as continuing good practices of social distancing and washing your hands and disinfecting surfaces. And with that, we wish you all a good day, and please stay safe.